Hello, Year 8. Welcome to your first online lesson on Of Mice and Men. In order to access this lesson, you're going to need your Week 1 booklet, which can be found on Show My Homework. That's the Week 1 work booklet. You're also going to need your copy of Mice and Men. If you haven't had a chance to get a copy of Mice and Men yet, there are PDF versions available online. You might also find it quite useful to follow the link for the audiobook that we've put just below in the description. So this is lesson one, George and Lenny. This lesson we're going to understand the different characters of George and Lenny. So Of Mice and Men by John Steinbeck was set in the 1930s in America, and this period of history was known as the Great Depression. We're going to learn more about the Great Depression next lesson, which is further along in this video. But the main thing you need to understand from this context is that our two main characters, George and Lenny, are what we call migrant workers. Now, migrant comes from the word migration, as in to move around. So these two characters move around the country working in different places. And then once their job is finished, they move on somewhere else. So today's big question and kind of the opening part of the lesson for you to have a bit of a think about is this question. Why do migrants live worse lives than those who remain in one place? You can link this back to some of our earliest history where originally mankind, we were hunter-gatherers. We didn't stay in one place. And part of our evolution was to start putting down roots and start building our own homesteads. But there are still people who move around a lot. We call these people nomadic sometimes, or migrants. So that big question, why is it that migrants live worse lives than those who remain in one place? So let's get to grips with the novel itself. I'd like you to open the very first page, which is a description of the Salinas River. If you've got your work booklet, this extract is also in there. What I'd like you to do is to read that opening. It's about three paragraphs long altogether. And I'd like you to underline all the animals that are mentioned in that opening. I think in the work booklet, I've underlined the first one for you, which is a lizard. Now, I think there's about 7 or 8 different animals mentioned in that opening. But what I'd like you to consider is, why does the writer begin with so many different images of animals? This is not an accident. Steinbeck deliberately does this. And a reoccurring image like this is what's known as a structural motif. So pause this video and have a go at that task in your booklet, please. So now you've finished that task on the very opening, I'd like you to read on in chapter one and focus on the contrasting descriptions of George and Lenny. So if you're using the audiobook to support you, follow the link that is in the description. You need to obviously start at the very beginning and stop around 1502. You need to stop at the bit where Lenny says, "Lenny giggled happily. I didn't forget that, you bet." So pause the video again and either read or listen to that part of the audiobook. So in order to show your understanding of the two characters of George and Lenny, which is, of course, our learning objective for this lesson, what I'd like you to do, using what's in your workbook already, I think I've already organised this for you, you've got two columns, one for George and one for Lenny. And in that table, I would like you to record, please, a comparison of the way they move, the way they're dressed, their different sizes, their eyes and their faces, and the way they talk or different language they use. What I'd like this to look like is quotations from the novel, and I'd like you to aim to discuss both surface meaning and implied meaning. So I'll give you an example of what I mean. At one point in chapter one, from the bit you've just read, Lenny is described as snorting into the water like a horse. So the surface meaning here was that he didn't have very good manners, that he was a bit clumsy in the way he did it. But the implied meaning might be that Lenny has more qualities of an animal than he does of a man. So you might need to go back into your copy of Mice and Men now, and maybe with a different highlighter, do George in one colour and Lenny in a different colour. So that task will probably take you between 15 and 20 minutes. So now you've finished that exploration and that comparison of George and Lenny, I'd like to return to this lesson's big question. Why is it that migrants live worse lives than those who remain in one place? And in order to kind of fully explore this question, you need to start thinking about your wider world knowledge. So some other prompt questions I've got for you here. What are the consequences of migration? What kind of lifestyle do these people tend to live? Or maybe why do these people have to migrate? Why do they have to move from place to place? Is it always a choice or is it a necessity? And this idea of living a worse life, well, what constitutes a good life then? How do you know whether you've made it? How do you know whether you are, as they say, living your best life or not? And then, of course, what evidence have we seen of George and Lenny's poor quality of life so far in the novel? A rather easy thing to think about is, where do they have to sleep? They haven't even got a tent between them. They're not going to stay in a hotel for the night. It looks like they're staying out in the open. So a final, maybe do a mind map for that one might be a good way to start. And that concludes your first lesson of week one. Okay, moving on to lesson two of week one. This lesson, we're going to be comparing the openings of two Steinbeck novels, one being Of Mice and Men and the other being The Grapes of Wrath. And no, it is not about angry fruit. So, as we said last lesson, Of Mice and Men is set in the 1930s in the middle of what was known as the Great Depression. So, I want you to think about the date of around the 1930s. What other significant world events are happening around this time? And we're going to explore these in a bit more detail on the next slide. So maybe just pause for a second. Can you think of maybe three things that are happening in the world around the 1930s? So what you need to know about the Great Depression in a nutshell. So the Great Depression was, as you know, in the middle of a huge amount of upheaval in the early 20th century. The first big event being, of course, the First World War. Now, America didn't join the First World War until about halfway through. But, of course, they did have high casualty rates, and the soldiers that joined the European forces suffered the same amount of injury and death as we did. So the young men who returned home to the USA had the same issues of shell shock, of injury, and of, indeed of mental health conditions. So America did not escape that fate as well. Then there is something you may not have heard of called prohibition. Now, if you prohibit something, you ban it. And the thing that was banned between 1919 all the way till 1933 was alcohol. Now, did that mean that nobody in the USA drank alcohol for getting on for 14 years? The answer, of course, is no. Of course, they still drank alcohol, which led to a rise in very famous gangsters such as Al Capone. Because, of course, as soon as you make something illegal, you open up a much more interesting market for it. Then we have a really serious financial downturn known as the Wall Street Crash. And this plummeted not only America, but most of the Western world into financial downturn. So there were huge problems with inflation, where money basically loses its value overnight. And as a result of this, as you can see lower down on this bullet pointed list, lots of people lost their jobs. Trade, so where you're selling and buying goods, and manufacturing, where you're making things, usually in factories, this all starts to stop. And so people start to lose their jobs. At one point, it was 25% of the country were unemployed. The only thing that did seem to keep going was the idea of farming. So, of course, everybody starts putting all of their energy into farming. But this provided another problem called soil erosion. Now, those of you that are good at geography might have heard of this, called the Dust Bowl effect. Basically, what it means is, if you keep planting crops in the same part of the earth over and over and over, you loosen the richest part of the soil, which is the topsoil. And that topsoil is very, very fertile. It's got all the nutrients in it. But of course, this was in the Midwest, home of the tornado, as we know from The Wizard of Oz. All this topsoil that had been made loose from overplanting starts to blow away, creating this dust bowl effect, which meant, of course, that if the part of the soil that had all the nutrients in it had blown away, then the crops are going to stop growing. And so this leads to more and more problems. So the Great Depression, in a nutshell, a really quite rubbish time for a lot of people, lots of unhappiness, huge amounts of unemployment. And as you can see, they named it very appropriately, the Great Depression. So to give you an idea of what people's lives were like during this time, I've got a collection of images for you from the 1930s. What I'd like you to do with this, especially if you've got your booklet handy, is perhaps summarise each image with three words, or perhaps even pose a question. So why does this man feel this way might be a question. I've got some music on in the background. I'll spend only maybe 5 seconds on each picture. So now you've had a look at those images and hopefully had a bit of a think about some words that might go with those images to summarise the mood around this time, I'd like you to now look at the opening, please, of The Grapes of Wrath, which you will be finding in your booklets. So it's about a page long altogether. And of course, this novel is also, like Of Mice and Men, set during the Great Depression. So as you're reading, I'd like you to consider, where can you see the links to the Great Depression, perhaps some of the things we discussed earlier in the bullet points? Where can you see any similarities or perhaps differences to the opening of Mice and Men? And how would you describe the mood of each opening and how is this created? An extra challenge might be what writer's methods, so things like metaphors, similes, contrast, what has Steinbeck used to convey the mood in these two openings? So if you'd like to pause the video now, that task will probably take you between 10 and 15 minutes. So now, using your knowledge of life in the Great Depression and also some understanding of that era from the two Steinbeck novels you've looked at, I'd like you to do is imagine that you are a young man of that era living in the 1930s. I want you to consider the questions below here. And as an extra kind of bit of a challenge, what you could do instead of just imagining and putting yourself in the shoes of such a person, instead, what you could do is maybe write a diary outlining your hopes and fears for the future. Some other questions you might consider, or what level of education do you think you would have? Did you fight in World War One, or maybe did your father fight in World War One? And what makes you angry about the current situation? So that concludes lesson two of week one. Moving on to our third lesson of week one now. Today we're going to understand the significance of George and Lenny's dream. Now, this is a dream as in an aspiration, a hope for the future. And the title we've given this lesson is Guys Like Us. So far in chapter one, George has alluded or made reference to several problems that Lenny causes him along the way. The first thing I'd like you to do, and again, this is in your work booklet that you can find on Share My Homework, I'd like you to make a list of maybe 4 or 5 advantages of having Lenny around and disadvantages of having Lenny around. So pause the video. That task should take you no more than maybe 3 to 5 minutes. What I'd like you to do now is to read on in chapter one. So you need to find the bit in your book where it says Lenny giggled happily. I didn't forget that, you bet. If you're using the audiobook to support you, you need to use the link below. Start at 1502 and you need to stop at the end of chapter one, which is 3652. And while you're listening to this part of chapter one, I'd like you to focus on George and Lenny's dream and maybe bullet point 7 details about the dream, about the little place that they're going to have. So pause this video and read on in chapter one of Mice and Men, or listen on your audiobook, please. So George and Lenny's dream could be described as a mini version, or a little microcosm, if you like, of the American dream. Now, the American dream links to the idea of the American Constitution, where all men are created equal and everybody therefore has the opportunity to achieve whatever they want in life if they're willing to work hard enough. Now, what you've got to consider about George and Lenny is that even though they are ranch hands, they are migrant farm workers, they don't currently get to keep any of the produce, any of the crops, if you like, that they help to farm. They don't own any property, and their dream of having a little place of their own would give them somewhere to belong, somewhere where they would be safe, secure, where they would always have food that they would own, they would grow, they would cultivate, and of course, shelter. So linking in what you learned about the Great Depression last lesson and now knowing something about the American dream and indeed George and Lenny's dream, what I'd like you to do is explain to me, please, how the dream, George and Lenny's dream, fits into the context of the Great Depression. So you might start with George and Lenny's dream links to the Great Depression because, and even better if you can use a quotation from the novel. That's quite a challenging task, that one. So maybe if you need a bit of help, go back and reread the section on the dream in the novel, or maybe do a bit of research on what is known as the American dream to support you. And finally, bringing this week's lessons to a close now, Lenny's role in the dream is much more simple than George's role. George seems to do most of the hard work in this dream, whereas Lenny's part of the dream is to have rabbits, to have responsibility and to get to tend them, and to go and pick alfalfa, which is a kind of green leafy plant, from the garden. So Lenny's version of the dream, this simple dream, it tells us a lot about his mental age and his ability. So the final thought maybe for this lesson and for this week is, how old mentally do you think Lenny really is? So you've now completed week one of Mice and Men. Well done. What I'd like you to do now is to go on to Show My Homework and complete the chapter one quiz. We'll be releasing week two's lessons on the 27th of April. That's on next Monday. Hope you all keep safe and well between now and then. This is Mrs. Allen signing out.